Load to Learn, making curriculum materials accessible.
Hello, I'm EA Draffan and I've been working with assistive technologies for many years, and in particular looking at the way audio and synthetic audio, or text-to-speech, can help with reading with those who have print impairment. One of the problems is that we need to compare the difference between what it might be when we hear something read by a very experienced narrator and perhaps someone who's not quite so experienced. And we're going to listen to that alternative now and then later on in the video see what it feels like to listen to synthetic speech.
Of all the things that Harry had said to him, beyond any revelation or taunt, nothing had shocked Voldemort like this. Harry saw his pupils contract to thin slits, saw the skin around his eyes whiten.
Mr. and Mrs. Dursley of number 4 Privet Drive were proud to say that they were perfectly normal, thank you very much. They were the last people you'd expect to be involved in anything strange or mysterious, because they just didn't hold with such nonsense.
So there you heard Stephen Fry narrating Harry Potter, and then you heard an amateur narrating the same story for her brother, who happened to want to listen to it in audio format. The voices were distinctive, clear, and I think they were very pleasant to listen to. They would be something that you'd want to do on a long journey. But text-to-speech can be very different. Text-to-speech, though, is not what you call speech-to-text. And in this case, you have Dragon Naturally Speaking working alongside Claro Reed. Here, I dictate into the text box. My dictation is then read back to me. It's read back with a synthetic voice, what we call TTS for short. But we have a debate. And the research seems to be coming out with some mixed messages. I think we need to look at it more carefully. I think we need to query it, and I think we need to do an awful lot more research before we can be sure who really benefits from text-to-speech. But let's have a look at what's being said. Someone is saying there's no significant difference in learning gains in students using a learning resource with synthetic voice audio narration as compared to a natural voice audio narration. In other words, students, when they're working with text, can learn just as well by having it as TTS. But TTS voices place a greater demand on cognitive resources to facilitate understanding in comparison to natural voices. They may be much harder to listen to, and what we know is that over time, we can actually find it very boring having a certain robotic voice without sufficient inflection to keep us interested. We can also find it very tiring. And there are certainly voices that jar. We may not like the sound of them. We may think that one voice is better than another. This is, of course, true of a natural voice. So some of us much prefer Stephen Fry compared to another reader. What we do feel is true, and I think this is something we need to think of very carefully with different students, high quality TTS and natural voices are more intelligible when compared to low quality TTSs. And high quality TTS voices result in higher comprehensibility scores. Now that's research. What we found is absolutely the case in this sort of type of work is that our students who have high quality TTSs who are dyslexic find them much easier to listen to, but listen to them at a different rate when compared to those students who are visually impaired and who are listening to perhaps more robotic voices, but at a much faster rate. So this is something to think about. TTS systems now offer increased naturalness of sounds when you compare them to the human voice. They allow for pauses. They respond to punctuation. They have the ability to have intonation. So there is now the debatable effect on the comprehension. It may sound like a human. But can what is being said be understood? And I think this is when you need to listen to them.
The Chiselhurst cave entrance will entrance you. With Roman and Druid remains, they will lead us with great effect. But watch it, as the campus will be affected by the red lead in the rocks. Also, particles will not diffuse in this atmosphere. It's too diffuse. Do you think I'll be all right?
The Chiselhurst cave entrance will entrance you. With Roman and Druid remains. There you'll lead us with great effect, but watch it, as the compass will be affected by the red lead in the rocks. Also, particles will not diffuse in this atmosphere, it's too diffuse. Do you think you'll be alright?
There you heard two voices. Charles, who was actually recorded from the internet in readwords.com, and Daniel, that was recorded via text help read and write. They both of them failed to notice a homophone in the centre of that paragraph. But on the whole, you could understand what they were saying, despite the poor quality of the audio. The problem for us was, in both cases, that we may have had a personal preference as to which voice we liked. This may also be true of female voices. So don't forget, you have a choice of gender. Notice in these two examples the speed and the difference it can make.
The girl with the bow in her hair was told to bow deeply when greeting her superiors.
The girl with the bow in her hair was told to bow deeply when greeting her superiors.
Did you hear the mistake? Once again, in the centre of that paragraph, there was a word that wasn't said correctly. But did you also notice the pauses? TTS synthesizers are usually good at resolving homophones when supplied with context. In other words, bow and bow, it should have heard that difference, or you should have been able to hear that difference. Scrub that. TTS synthesizers are usually good at resolving homophones when supplied with context. He bowed, she had a bow. But without sufficient context on either side, in other words, a longer sentence, they very often make mistakes. There's also the issue of spell checking. If the TTS synthesizer is supplied with just a single word, and perhaps one of a spelling correction that's in a list with no context, how is it going to be able to tell the difference between lead and led, read and read, or even reading and reading? We know those are issues that have yet to be resolved completely, and they can be very confusing for dyslexic readers. Sometimes a robotic voice can be quite useful. The robotic voice is very often better if you are going to have the reading speed up around 400 words per minute. Bear in mind that we normally read around 300. Your dyslexic reader may be only reading at 180 words per minute, or even 150 or below. So someone reading at 400 words per minute, or listening to text, I should say, at that speed, has to be a very proficient reader. And they're normally someone who's been blind from birth. That is when the robotic voice can be incredibly helpful, because it chops up the words. If you use Jane, Emily, Serena, or any of the high quality TTSs, you may well find that if you increase the speed, the comprehensibility, the understandability, the readability, whatever you want to call it, starts to be reduced. It's not as easy to understand them. Microsoft Sam, one of the basic voices, very often is at its best when it's used at speed. And the old deck talk voices that were used by the augmentative communication devices and blind students several years ago sounded awful when they were used at slow speed, but when increased became quite intelligible. So we need to be aware of the fact that our TTSs differ. And to make the most of text-to-speech, we do need to consider which high quality voice we want. But on the whole, the high quality voice is the one that suits the student who has dyslexia. We need to make the most of this voice by sometimes using bimodal reading systems. This is where you're thinking of text highlighting and text output with speech. Or you're thinking of text output and you yourself are controlling the amount of text you see. You can decide whether you want blue on yellow or whether you just want the word highlighted without a colour background. But whichever way you work, very often having the words in front of you as the text is being read out can be very helpful. Although some students find this distracting and you need to know which method is best. Think about the speed very carefully. Average speeds do vary. Research has shown 120 to 160 words per minute are probably a good reading rate for someone using text-to-speech. But you need to be able to control it. You yourself need to be able to control it, not the computer. So you need to take command of that text-to-speech and go into those background settings and fiddle with them until you're happy. Here are some settings. This is where we've got Sarah Prock's voice using Jess, and we're able to change the pitch. This can be extremely important if you're looking at the rate of reading. Also, we know that some of the software programs don't offer this option, so you need to know that. Balabalka is one of the free ones. Try it. Try changing the pitch and try changing the rate until you feel comfortable. Claro Read also has pauses, as do other more expensive text-to-speech voices and programs such as TextHelp. Allow that pause setting to be set so that in between a long sentence you can have a pause where there's a comma, you can have a pause after words, you can perhaps have a longer pause after a full stop. If you have pausing, be aware that this will also impact on the speed. We know that if you read too slowly, or you have the text-to-speech reading back to you too slowly, you may forget what you've read at the beginning of the sentence. So listening to very slow speech may not always be the best answer for you. Now, this is an important distinction that we want to talk about now. Most people think of voices as being part of a software program. But actually, the voice is something separate. Your computer, your tablet, your mobile phone may have several different voices on it, or you may have to buy a voice separately. And that can be very worthwhile if you want to have one that particularly suits your needs, or if you want to have one in a different accent, American, Australian, whatever. You can even have Sangeeta, who's Indian English. There are lots of choices out there. Make sure you explore them. But then you need to also make sure that you explore the software that can accept them, because not all software will accept all the voices available. So you need to be aware of that. The software will allow you to choose the settings on that voice. So you purchase a voice, the software then offers you the settings or the app. So if you have a Blio app on an iPad, there will be voiceover to get you into the Blio app, and it might read the menus to you. But then if you want to use Blio, you are going to have extra voices to be able to make the most of the text-to-speech. So making those decisions isn't as easy as it sounds. But here's an example of two voices that have been made available by TextHelp and Sarah Prock.
The girl with the bow in her hair was told to bow deeply on greeting her superiors.
The girl with the bow in her hair was told to bow deeply when greeting her superiors.
The first voice you heard was Jack, and the second voice was Jess. They didn't do too well with the homophone, but they're not expensive for those who are in education. And Gist Tectis and Sarah Prock have made them available for you now. So Go and try them if you're in a school or in a foreign... Not all voices have to be expensive or use expensive programs. So go and try Jack and Jess if you can, if you're in a school, college or university. I hope that this has given you some insight into the complexities of audio and synthetic audio, the differences between human narration and text-to-speech. Try them for yourselves. Thank you.
Thank you for watching. For more tutorials or information about Load to Learn, please visit loadtolearn.org.uk or contact us on 0300 303 8313. Copyright 2012 Dyslexia Action and R&IB. Licensed under the Creative Commons license by attribution for non-commercial purposes and shared alike.